Hi Merci folks, this is Elina and today I will talk about my own process of applying for an artistic doctorate. If you are looking to apply, this might be helpful to you, or if you know someone interested in applying for a doctorate in the arts, forward this video to them. Please like this video in order to help the YouTube algorithm recommend it to the people to whom it's the most relevant. So the whole process took me about 2 years, I'm not joking. First of all, I needed to determine my geographic area because there are a lot of continents on our planet and I was interested in conducting research in English. So I started browsing, first of all, for continents, then countries. I realized that the requirements differ a lot by a continent because there are various doctoral programs and I'm linking the video above for the programs in music and performing arts, in artistic research, doctoral programs in the arts around the world. And I realized that I have to concentrate on one continent because I wouldn't be able to fulfill all the different kinds of requirements for each continent, each country I would like to apply to in order to conduct my research in English. Since I was already in Europe and wanted to stay in Europe, I decided to concentrate on the European countries during this year of my applications. So I started researching the schools in Europe, the requirements, the deadlines, and of course the potential supervisors. I didn't apply to all the schools I found because I realized that at some schools, there can be no one who can potentially supervise my project and be fluent in my topic. Of course, your supervisor doesn't have to specialize in your topic, but they have to be fluent in it. They have to be able to supervise you. Because if you are doing a research on, I don't know, modern dance, and your supervisor really specializes in historical dance, probably it's not gonna be a match that will help you with your progress, help you advance in your research. And supervisors have to be able to guide you and they have to be interested, at least to some extent. They have to be able to relate to your topic, to what you are writing about, what you are practicing, I mean your art that you're practicing, your genre. Some schools do require an approval from your potential supervisor to be, and some schools don't. I applied to both kinds of schools because sometimes I saw that there is a chance that I will find someone who would be able to supervise me even if I don't have their signed approval at the moment. So pretty much this is what I did during the first year of my research on doctoral schools in the arts in Europe. During the second year, I first and foremost started working on my proposal, which is the doctoral exposé. This is a huge subject on its own, and I'll be happy to make another video just specifically on that if it will be helpful to you, because this took me about 5 months or so from the first draft, the first outline, and to the point when I actually sent it to all the schools. So generally for the first round you must, it's everywhere like this, you must submit your proposal, resume, recordings if you are doing performing arts, and maybe a letter of intent or something like that, like a cover letter. I always do add it anyway because I view it as a polite way of saying hello. Some countries require you to re-evaluate your diplomas or apostille them. Double check that, double check all the requirements in a timely manner because this can actually take a while, and if you are going to need apostilles, make sure that you either can go to that country where the diploma was issued, maybe it's your home country and you live there, or you have someone in that country, if you're no longer there, that someone can take care of it for you. It has to be notarized, maybe translated, depends on the languages. My diplomas were in English, so I didn't need translations. and then apostilled. If you need to re-evaluate your diploma, it's going to be a more complicated process. I didn't need to do this, luckily, so I'm not going to give an advice on that, but you can easily find online what you need to do. Check for language requirements. In most of the cases, you will have to have a C1 in English if it's not your native language or if you didn't finish high school and got a degree or multiple degrees in English, which was my case. If you're applying in the German-speaking area, you can have, in most of the cases, either English C1 or German C1. And you can be native in one of these languages. And if you are applying to another country where you still can conduct your research in English, but maybe you're from that country and you speak the language of that country, it's great, it's an advantage. And if you don't, please make sure that you can conduct your research in English, otherwise you might end up being in trouble. Some schools require you to fill out an online application form that they have on the website. For that form, you might need to have a shortened version of your proposal, which is like 300 words or so. So be ready to actually shorten your proposal. Don't do it quickly in 15 minutes. Do it a bit in advance so you can reread it, because sometimes it seems to us who are writing a proposal for almost half a year that things are clear, but they might not be clear if you take 10, 12 pages of your proposal, whatever number that is, and put it suddenly into 300 words, which is this much of text. It might not be clear to the people who are reading it for the first time ever and they need to pre-qualify you. This would be around number zero, and then you would need to send your full proposal for the first round. Please give it to someone else to read and ask them honestly if they can actually understand briefly what the project is about, because if they can't, you need to work on it more. Don't put it off until the last moment. There are other things you might be asked in the first round of your application, along with the things I mentioned above. Some schools ask you for the state of the art. Some others ask for a personal statement. Oh, one school actually asked me to provide a list of potential conferences where I would be presenting. So I needed to research and find some conferences where I potentially would go if I ended up studying at that school. It was a lot, and I spent like half a day doing that. Be ready that you might be asked all these things that you have not done before, and you will need to find a way to accomplish them in order to send your application. What else did I do? I double-checked, triple-checked. I allocated some time just for that when my application was already done and ready to go. I knew I need to reread everything multiple times, make sure I didn't forget to attach one file maybe or something, because either you are sending like 20 PDFs with your diplomas, resumes, transcripts, whatever, or you are sending one huge PDF. My longest one was 46 pages of stuff. And you need to make sure that you're including everything in there and it's clear and your pages are numbered and like you don't have the diploma and then the transcript and then the apostille for the diploma. So it has to be in order. Your diploma, your apostille, your transcript, for example. Just be organized. Clear up all the questions you have with the office. Email the secretary. Don't be afraid to bother them. It's their job to answer your questions. They might be anything. For example, you can inquire about the documents, or you can inquire about technical procedures during the interview, your exam, whatever. You have to know what's going on, and nothing has to be unclear. After you send your huge PDF, or a lot of PDFs, just sit and wait. And wait more, and wait longer, and even longer, and it just takes a while. And then eventually you will receive either a rejection, which happens and it's fine, or an invitation to an interview slash exam. So if you got an invitation, congrats! But what are you gonna do next? So usually with the invitation email, you will get a structure of your interview. For example, they might want 25 minutes of your presentation, then maybe 10 minutes for Q&A, and then I don't know, 5 minutes to discuss without you. So if it's live, you just leave the room, or if it's Zoom, they kick you out, and that's it. So first, let's talk about the presentation. Prepare it, write it down, outline it. You don't have to write the entire text, of course, but make sure that you know what you're going to talk about and in which order, and don't copy everything from your exposé, from your proposal, please, because they have read your proposal. They will know who you are. They will know about your project, but they will want to hear it from you. So engage in your project. Maybe you're sick of it by now. Maybe you don't want to see your proposal or your documents, but you have to kind of take a break and then make yourself fall in love with it again. Because this is your favorite thing to do, isn't it? Otherwise, why are you doing it? Don't do it. Stop now. But if you still want to proceed, and if you're getting ready for that interview, write out your 20-25 minute presentation, whatever it's going to be, and maybe include some things, maybe include some examples that were not there, that were not in your exposé. Maybe have a demonstration. If you are a performing artist, maybe you'll have a performance. I don't know if it's live or if it's going to be on Zoom and you can stream a recording. I streamed something because my interviews were all during the spring and summer 2020. Of course, we're all stuck at home on Zoom, always. So I just streamed a snippet of a video of my performance to demonstrate something that I was arguing about in my exposé, in my presentation. And now practice, 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 practice. Don't just write out the text. I don't know how many times I practiced my presentation. I can't tell you. I did it so many times on my own. And I did it with a timer. Because if you run longer, they might just stop you because they will have a ton of other people after you and they have to be on time. So make sure it's not too long. It's better to be 30 seconds short rather than 2 minutes too long, because if they cut you and you're not done, it's a bad impression. You don't want that. Practice it live or on Zoom, depends. If it's on Zoom, Zoom somebody, like I Zoomed my husband who was in the next room, but we had a Zoom rehearsal of my presentation, of my interview. I Zoomed with our family friend who helped me prepare, and he's doing a PhD now. He's almost done. He did a mock interview. So he actually did provide some stressful situation for me, so I could practice, and he asked very, very nasty questions, like the questions you don't want to hear during your doctoral interview. This is what he did. I actually ended up being scared for that interview the most. Not an interview, but the mock interview. Zoom your parents. Zoom your friends and family. If it's live, I mean, probably a lot of things are not going to happen live for a while, but then maybe invite someone over. Social distancing, whatever. Put them in the other end of the room or the apartment or outside. If the weather is nice, just practice your interview outside. Take out your computer and just invite a friend or a group of friends and go to the park and practice your interview. I mean, you have to be able to do it in your sleep. You probably will do it in your sleep and not even once. Prepare to answer possible questions that you might be asked after your presentation. They might be about your project, they probably will be about your project mostly, but they might also be about you and why you made the decision to apply for this doctoral program or generally a doctoral program in the arts, this school, this city, this country, whatever. And if you have no idea why, then maybe think about it. It's a good time to actually determine it for yourself. So also write down answers for the possible questions you might be asked. You don't even need to look at them during the interview in Zoom, but if you have written it down, you will have it in your head. Something will pop up, so you won't be, you know, hanging frozen that they will think that you have an unstable internet connection. And write out a list of questions that you would like to ask them, because the Q&A section is not only for them to ask you questions, but you might have questions about the school, about the supervisors, about the environment at the school, stuff like that. And if you have a chance, if there is time, if they ask you questions about you and why you decided to go to that school, make sure that you do a research about that school and you know about your supervisors, you know the work that they have done, and you can say something about it, maybe even briefly. Oh, I saw that you have these and those projects running by some people, fellow doctoral students, and I'm applying to the supervisor because I have read this article and that article, and I think it might be fulfilling for me, and it will help me with my research. So things like that. Make it personal. Make them see that you know about the school. Also, you could add something that because of your project and its values, it will add to the atmosphere of the school. Your work will contribute. So you will actually bring something with what you are doing to them. So it's an exchange. It's always an exchange. And make it sound like one. After the interview, you don't need to follow up because they are very, very busy with paperwork. And they will most likely tell you very soon if you got accepted. If not, maybe you would wait longer. Also, you might need to wait longer if you're applying for a doctoral with a fellowship position. In that case, there is a lot of bureaucracy involved because they have to allocate the finances, and especially if it's governmental, it's even longer. It can take ages, and they might need to have all the signatures and all the approvals, and only after they have gotten all that info and all the paperwork between the school and the government, they can send the official emails to the applicants. So if you are waiting, don't think that you are for sure rejected, because you never know. Don't assume anything until you actually do receive that email, okay? I can tell you from my experience that I got the acceptance from my school the next day, next evening, because there are also interviews taking place the day after. So we had 2 days of interviews. I think I was probably first because of my last name. So when they finished during the day of the next day, they closed up the process, and I already got an unofficial email from our dean that evening. And I can't describe the feeling. That was something. If you didn't see my video where I am explaining why I opted in for a doctoral program in artistic research, it's up here. If you would like me to make a separate video on how to write a doctoral proposal, let me know in the comments. Let me know if you have questions, other comments, your feedback. Like this video if this was useful. Forward it to the people who are applying or are thinking to apply for a doctorate program in the arts. Subscribe to this channel if you're interested in further updates from me on artistic organization, artistic research, piano performance. Hit the bell button not to miss any upcoming video. I wish you an amazing week, and I will see you in the next one. Bye.